another episode of Send the Two Green Connector. With us today, we have Adam Jordan.
Hello.
Tom Webster.
Howdy, everyone.
And myself, Eric Fine, for our first ever video cast.
Woo! Video!
We're on video. We are live.
Hello. Right. Hi,
here.
Mom.
See me, my face right here.
So for all of you at home who are downloading this podcast, probably listening to it on a Monday, Tuesday, or slacking and waiting until Thursday, Friday, you are missing out on the 10 p.m. Eastern Time live video stream of our sexy faces.
Yeah.
So in other news, what's going on with you guys this week?
I have played all the games.
Tom, yeah, I saw Tom's list of games. Tom has played a lot of games.
I've been making up for a few games the past couple weeks.
You guys getting anything fun outside of the games?
I don't know. It all happened so fast.
I had a little run-in with Amazon where my products are not getting here on time.
I have that issue.
Normally, I don't care. But I was really looking forward to this shipment. So when it came today instead of yesterday, I was a little upset, but it was still like Christmas.
Finally
What'd you get? Got me an Amazon Dot.
Oh, nice.
Nice.
Very cool.
So for those not familiar, it's like their Echo, which has their Alexa personal assistant on it, but it's the size of a hockey puck. So
nice.
it's half the price, still full featured, has a small built-in stereo or speaker, but you can still connect to Bluetooth. So we have some towers that we connect it to. Works great. There are actually games on that thing.
Interesting. How does that work?
Game with that.
So more of the classic
Alexa,
ones.
Alexa, beat Dark Souls.
Yeah. And then you sit back and cry because she plays it better than anyone could ever. But there's the basic example is 20 questions. And that one works pretty well. There's one that specializes in actors or characters even. So we tried to do some really obscure stuff. Like I did Johnny Bravo and it got it really quick. She did a Big Daddy from BioShock and it got it within 20 questions. I did Piccolo from DBZ, and it got it in 20 questions. I mean, it was pretty freaking good.
Nice. But
there are some traditional style games, and by traditional, I mean older. You know those text-based adventures? Go north. Go south. Examine that rock. Those kind of games? They have them. I'm going to add that skill, and I'm going to play one of those through Alexa.
Yes. Oh my God, resort to the Alexa.
Exactly. I'm going to play a text adventure game via Alexa. I expect it to be terrible, but I'm going
hey,
to do it.
You never know. You never know.
There's a Yeti Hunter. It'll be fun.
I love text adventures. I played through all of my Zork games in my youth.
I never did text adventure, but I had like a text strategy game. Think of like Clash of Clans earlier without any premium model.
Oh.
And I would set alarms at night to wake up to do things. There was a few friends of mine that would do that as well, even more so than I would.
I don't know that I would like that.
Oh, it's fun. It's a big war game with like this political bullshit where you have to, it was called Star Kingdoms. Where you had to like partner up with people and you essentially get entire sectors, which is like you're putting a sector of 20 people. Sectors join alliances and then alliances war with each other.
Gotcha.
And there's a lot of politics because all of a sudden you'll have three alliances out of nowhere going over the bit or going at the big dog kind of thing. It was a lot of fun. It went from about 50,000 players to about 3,000 now.
Nice.
Oh, wow.
So had a big fall.
Yeah. People are still playing, though. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I mean, for a game to be that old.
I almost signed up, though. I was so close. I'm like, man, I missed this. I am missing this in my life. And then I'm sure after about a week of it, I'd realize I am not missing this because I actually now have a life.
Don't lie. You don't have to lie. It's okay. You're on a podcast about video games on a live streaming web service about video games. You don't have to have a life here.
Oh, it's a great life right now because I get to do a lot of normal video games. Yes. But speaking of the video games, Tom, you had an impressive list of what you've touched on. So skim over the bullshit.
Yeah, let's hear some of these. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I did play a game of Dota 2. I need to start getting serious and play one ranked match a day until I can break 1,000 MMR. I don't think I'm going to. And that's a 1,000 gain, not like my baseline of 1,000. Like, I'm a scrub, but I'm not that much of a scrub.
Yeah, good.
I have some self-respect left a little bit until Dota takes the rest. I did load up Counter-Strike, not CSGO, not Source. Like original Counter-Strike. 1.6. Yes. And it was fun. It was a good time. People are still playing, believe it or not. I mean, it's not like thousands and thousands and thousands of people online at a time, but, you know, 2,000, 3,000 at any one time. Server browser still works. You can still jump into a game. It's
very cool.
Yeah. I shouldn't be surprised, but I was.
Yeah.
That actually reminds me. I was going to say, that actually reminds me. You said old server's still up. Halo 1 Classic Combat Evolved.
Yes.
Server's still up. Our buddy D-Laz told me that a while ago they cracked it to where it didn't require GameSpy servers anymore. He showed me a screenshot. There was probably a good 15, 16 servers up and running. Nice. Granted, half of them were hanging high, but.
you know, that happened in Halo 1. By far, Halo CE was some of the best multiplayer I've ever played. And it didn't feel like a good PC shooter. It still felt like a console shooter that got ported, but
because it was.
Yeah, because it was. But it was so much fun. So I played some Rocket League to test out a piece of hardware that we're going to review later. I played Inside, which we're going to talk about later.
Oh, yeah. I have to talk about Inside.
There's a lot to talk about there. I played a lot of The Witcher, but...
How far into that are you?
I'm at chapter 2. I want to say I'm about halfway through chapter 2 out of like 5 or 6 chapters, and then there's an epilogue. Okay. So
yeah.
I'm still scratching the surface. It's a big-ass, long RPG. Unfortunately, I can't see any way to tell how long I've actually played, but I've probably put about 15 hours into it so far. That said, I'm not speedrunning this.
I've seen you on that and your next game a lot on Steam this week.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. So I was going to like go full force and play The Witcher nonstop until I beat it, but I got distracted. I watched a YouTube video of a couple different people that do game design analysis and talk about, you know, how to build games and, you know, the psychological aspects that keep people coming back. And there's one game they kept talking about, so I bit the bullet during the sale and I bought Dark Souls because I hate myself on a fundamental level. I love Dark Souls. Now, I understand that the first game is widely regarded as kind of this broken masterpiece of, it's a great game, but there are some things that are just awful about it compared to later games in the series. And I'm really looking forward to Dark Souls 2 now. Because of what I've read. But Dark Souls is as difficult as they say. You know, you will die over and over and over again, but it's not... I don't want to say it's not frustrating, because it is, because you'll walk into a battle with something literally 10 times your size. You will get literally squashed to death. Like, the guy will run over and just step on you, and you will explode into pieces, and you're just dead. And then "you died" comes up on the screen. You're like, yeah, I get it. You don't have to tell me. Like, I see the bones, man. But it never feels unfair. Every time I get stabbed in the chest and the guy literally, like, kicks me off of his sword as he pulls it out of my, like, bleeding to death corpse, it's because I went for that one last hit. Because I hit him, like, 3 times. I'm like, I can get a 4th in. 3 was even too much, but I can get a 4th in if I try and if I'm ballsy enough. No. No, you can't. No, you won't. Now you're dead. You're dead. It's yeah, my fault.
Go ahead.
Say, I've heard that this is a game where it never gets easier. You're never given items that really make it easier. You just learn the dance and get good, kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, to some extent, there are some classes, because Dark Souls is actually... I went into this thinking, okay, I'm going to balance my Witcher RPG with my Dark Souls action game, and that's not how this works at all. Dark Souls is as much of an RPG as The Witcher is. There's equipment balancing. I picked up a halberd, which is like a giant stabbing implement, if you don't know what a halberd is, right? I was like, oh, this is going to be fucking sweet. I've got huge range. I can just stab everyone and never get close, never get stabbed again. No one can ever hurt me. I equipped it, and the game says, that strength stat is laughable. A, you can't swing this one-handed if you tried. And I did try. My guy like did this half-hearted lunge across the battlefield that took like 7 seconds to like do a weak-ass swing. But you can wield it with two hands, which means you have no shield. So I get like one stab in, and the guy's like exhausted. I'm like, okay, that's not going to work. So you've got all of these statistics to manage, mixed with all of this equipment to manage, mixed with getting good. And there are certain classes that are range-based, so you can just sit back and, you know, do your pansy, I'm going to fire arrows into these guys until they die, but it gets easier, but not that much easier.
Mm.
But I'm really liking it so far. I'm 10-ish hours into the game. But it's hard, it never feels unfair. Everything bad that happens is my fault.
Yeah.
To cap it off, before we talk about Inside, there's one more game I played. And it is illegal. You cannot find it anymore unless you go to the depths of the internet. It's illegal because Nintendo shut this the fuck down right after it got released. Another Metroid 2 remake. This is, as the name implies, a remake of Metroid 2, made in the style of Metroid Fusion or Metroid Zero Mission. It's really, really good. And I understand why Nintendo sent their lawyers after it, because, I mean, on one hand, legally, they have to protect their trademark or they lose it. On the other hand, fucking grow a pair, Nintendo. Let this shit exist. Other people let fan shit exist. Just get over it.
It got too big.
Really good.
Yeah, that's an awfully big IP to.
Oh, good though.
Yeah, I mean, to a point, if that wasn't so good and didn't blow up the way it did, just like the Pokemon Platinum or something like that, those two blew up way too large, so they had to snuff it out. Had they not been that big, they would have been left alone.
I don't get how Nintendo can even imagine that this will impact our sales in any way. Nintendo, when it comes to Metroid, right, the another Metroid 2 remake, they don't give a fuck about Metroid anymore, at least if you ask them any time within the past, 6 years, since Retro Studios stopped making Metroid Prime games. They seriously don't care about Metroid 2, a game that came out on the Game Boy, like 20 years ago. That's not impacting sales. Another 2D Pokemon game that's a mashup isn't impacting sales. I get why they have to do it. I get why their lawyers are angsty, and they're lawyers, so they just piss all over everything anyway. And if you're a lawyer, I don't apologize. And it's our official position at 72 Pin Connector that you're a snake.
Wow. Not official position. That is just
not official. No.
We're gonna get sued now. Just watch. But I get why they have to. But that's shitty. It's just shitty.
Yeah.
That said, you can find this game around. You can find the Pokemon game that got shut down around on the internet, and you can play these things regardless of what Nintendo's lawyers say. So get on it. Another Metroid 2 remake is amazing.
Tom, this is kind of off topic, but have you ever played Axiom Verge?
Yes. Okay. I mean,
I've heard it's really good. It's kind of a Metroid. It's a Metroidvania kind of throwback game. Supposedly it's really good, and the guy that made it, it's one guy that made it. He did all the music and all the programming and art and everything. So
yeah. I bought it. I haven't played it, I should say. I've been waiting because I need to get through Dark Souls or else I will never finish it.
Has anyone played that Pokemon Platinum? Or it's Platinum, right?
No, it's something else.
Well, either way, has anyone made the fan-made one? Because I heard it's fantastic.
I have not. Well,
okay. Anyway, I just thought I would ask because I'm kind of on that kick. What you been playing now?
What have I been playing? I've been playing Rocket League, obviously. I have been playing The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus. I bought that on release day. I'm so bad at this game now because I haven't played in a while, so I haven't gotten as far into it as I wanted to, for sure. But it's nice that they have some more content, and I'm having fun exploring it, for sure.
Yeah, you were talking to me the one night you were playing it. That almost pulled me in to download it.
Yeah, oh, really?
I haven't done it yet. And hearing you play through it, it's like, oh, my crack's back. I need to get my fix.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun diving back into it, for sure. The new character is fun. It's kind of a cool the active item that you can use. It basically steals, if there's a pedestal with an item on it, you can either take that item or you can use your spacebar item, and it steals the item away, and you get a random stat bonus, and then that item's effect that you stole will now activate when you use your spacebar item as well. So if you're sucking in these, it's called the void. So if you're sucking in these active spacebar items, you're getting random stat bonuses, and you still get to use all of those spacebar effects every time you use the void.
So is it possible to get a D20 through that, where it re-rolls, absorbs what was there, and gives you a new?
I don't know. I think if you were to do that, you would steal it, and then the first time you used it, it would re-roll void, I'm sure. That would be my assumption. But I don't know.
That would be nuts.
Yeah, no kidding. So I'm looking forward to exploring that. I haven't played it a whole lot, but definitely will be playing more of that.
So how is it going back after such a long break?
It's tough because I'm not good anymore. I'm taking bad damage, and I'm not getting the devil deals because of it. I'm not getting as far into it. You know, before, when I was playing it a lot, I could, every other run, make it all the way through. Pretty much. I even got to, I think I beat the chest with the Lost at one point.
Oh, wow.
Which, if you're not familiar, the Lost is a character that cannot have HP. If you get hit once, the run is over. Unless you have an item that helps with that. But anyways.
Yeah.
So V Dobby in chat says it's Pokemon Uranium, which it is.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that's the name of the game. So if you want to go look up Pokemon Uranium and go find your illegal copy, go for it. But a question for you, Adam, from V Dobby, is, have you ever seen have you seen the new potato peeler item?
Potato peeler? No, I have not.
Oh, that, God. What the hell would a potato peeler
do? I don't know what that could
deal?
Be. I don't know what that could be, but I would definitely like to see that.
I would just... What we'll like, makes back. Really long tears or something?
I don't know. That could be a number of things. I did get an item today, right before the podcast, actually. What was it called? Glass Cannon. And it, like...
Deuce?
Yeah, it was a spacebar item, and I went to use it, and it shot this gigantic tear and then took my health down to half a heart. And I was like, oh, no.
Oh, God.
Oh, so, sweet. So the potato peeler is you sacrifice a red heart, and you get a Meat Boy piece.
Oh, wow.
So that sounds incredibly OP if you have a lot of spare hearts on a floor.
Oh,
because
yeah.
Because those Meat Boys are really useful.
Yeah.
I remember there was a challenge where you start with one.
Mm-hmm.
And the fun thing is once you have one, the four horsemen always drop a meat cube, and it always stays the same one. So you don't go meat cube and then a band-aid. It'll stay the same. Mm-hmm. So at that challenge, you will end up having two Meat Boys running around if you do it right. And that is OP as fuck.
Yeah.
I mean, it is game breaking.
And if you podcast listeners would like to interact with our podcast every Friday night at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, you can join twitch.tv/72pinconnector, and we too will read your comments.
Yes.
If they don't suck.
Yeah.
If they don't suck. If you just start like spamming like Kappa please or Volvo please or Dire Tide please.
Eventually we're going to have to deal with that. But
yeah, I'm going to ignore you and spam you back.
I played some Afterbirth Plus, and then I played a game. I didn't play very much of this at all, but I want to play more because it's really cool. Disc Jam. So Disc Jam is currently in beta. It is, if you know the game Windjammers, it is basically Windjammers. If you don't know the game Windjammers, it's basically a cross between like air hockey and tennis. So you've got one or two people on each side of the field. It's just a tennis court, and then you have like a disc that you throw back and forth, and the objective is to get it past the person to the back end zone area. So it's in beta now. You can go to the website. It's from a company called, I think, High Horse Gaming, and it's just two guys, High Horse Entertainment. So if you can go to highhorseentertainment.com and download the demo for this for free. It's a lot of fun. I saw it on Twitter because I follow a lot of Rocket League players, and this game took that by storm. Everybody in the Rocket League community is going crazy for this game. So it's got a similar addicting quality to it.
And for those who are unfamiliar with Windjammers, Windjammers was actually a very competitive game. It never hit the scene like your Dotas and stuff, but there were competitive tournaments locally for Windjammers just because it's quick, it's very fast, and it's just addictive as hell.
It seems like it has a decent learning curve to it too, because there's like certain like special combinations and stuff you can do and counters and things like that. I played through the tutorial and then the advanced tutorial, and then I played online and just got destroyed immediately. But
I mean, I'll try this.
Yeah, I think we should all download it and play it sometime soon. We can all start at the same level, and I think it'd be a lot of fun.
Sounds like something that we could stream.
I was just about to say, for those interested, if you didn't catch the site in here that Adam said and you don't want to rewind, we'll tweet out the site after the show, as well as we probably will have some streaming of this going on shortly after the show.
Definitely. I plan on playing some tonight. So I played some of that. Very cool. Check it out. And then the last game I played was Inside, which I sat down and played in one sitting.
Wow.
And I haven't done that in a long time. Now, that being said, I played the demo like a couple weeks ago and picked up where I left off in the demo and then played in one sitting. One or two sittings, really. Might have been two sittings.
So if you don't know what Inside is, if you ever played a game called, why did I just blank on that?
Limbo.
Yes, thank you.
Because you're lost in Limbo.
Wow, Tom.
Where to go.
Right. So if you ever played Limbo, it's by the same people. It's the same type of game, the same type of gameplay. So if you know Limbo, you know what you're getting into when you play Inside to some extent.
Sort of. It's Limbo, but better. That's how I describe it. In every way better.
Completely fucked up. The whole thing is fucked up. The nice thing is Inside, unlike Limbo, doesn't have a whole lot of puzzles where you bash your face against the wall and it's some weird solution that you just can't come up with yourself.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff in Limbo too, there was like moments where you just, it would be reasonable for you to die there, and then you know not to do that. Like, there's less of that in Inside. There's not so many cheap deaths that just happen and you're like, okay, well, I guess can't do that there.
Yeah, Limbo seemed to kill you a lot just for the freak out moments of holy shit, is that a giant spider?
Everyone knows that moment. That is like the Limbo moment.
Anybody that's
Everyone
played it
knows
the giant spider. Yeah.
I think that was in the demo too, so that's not really even a spoiler.
Yeah, but I loved Inside so much.
I've heard there's parts in Inside that I haven't played the game, but at one spot will kill you. So you're trained to think this will kill you, but at a later spot, what would kill you would actually save you or prevent you from dying.
Yeah.
Sort of.
It's odd. It definitely fits. It does break some gameplay rules where you think one thing, they teach you one thing, it ends up being something completely different, but it works in the story. Whereas Limbo was more freak out, oh my god, this is so gross, oh my god, what the fuck is going on, sort of horror and suspense. Inside is more of the existential dread of what the hell is going on, what's happened, and what's happening to the world. Why am I in this position? And it pulls that off very, very well.
That's why I played it in one sitting, is because every moment, you have no idea what's going on. There is not one word of dialogue in this entire game. So there is no exposition whatsoever. There's no briefing. There's no training. There's no story background. There's nothing to read. There's no audio logs. You start. There's no HUD. You start walking to the right. There's no explanation of controls. There's two controls. You can jump and you can grab things. It's so well done. It's so cinematic. All the visuals are completely just outstanding. It's got the best animation. Beautiful. It's got the best animation I've ever seen in any game.
It reminds me of... Yeah. So did you guys ever play or see the old game, the old PC game, Another World?
No.
It was famous for using, basically high FPS rotoscoped animation, if I remember correctly. Hmm. So everything was very realistic looking, and the animations were, real people being shot through special cameras to be put in the game. It really looks like that, except without the nasty side effects you get from rotoscoping. Like, imagine if the original Mortal Kombat was in 60 frames per second. That sort of animation where it looks almost real life. Inside does that, and it does it very well.
Yeah.
It's going to be one of those games that continues looking really good, kind of like Wind Waker, because they're not going for hyper-realism. They're going for a
very unique visual style.
Yeah,
it's less good textures style. And more insanely cool lighting effects. Fog, dark areas, shadows, things like that. It looks really good.
So here's a question from someone who hasn't played it. How long of a game is this? Is this a big time commitment? Or it sounds like it's pretty quick.
Took about 3 hours.
Did it in one.
Sat down and played through the rest in 3 hours. Yep.
Shit, that's a night at Rocket League.
Yeah. But
that was such an engaging 3 hours, though.
Yeah. I would say, at $15, maybe it's a little much if it goes on sale. So I got it for 10. I feel like I got my $10 worth out of it, especially because there is hidden stuff. It's not just, run through it once and you're done. There's an entire subplot that you can get to, which we're not going to go into because that's full of spoilers. And if you want to look it up, you can go to YouTube.
Yeah.
The way I put that pricing, $12 gets you a ticket to a movie for an hour and a half to 2 hours. If this game is 3 hours and it is really fucking good, $15 is well worth it.
It's one of the most intentional, well-made games I've seen in a long time.
It oozes polish. There's nothing about this game that feels accidental.
I read a comment or a review that said it is exactly the way the developers wanted it to be. Like, everything is just... There's no odd anything. There's no quirks to it. It's just...
It's not the best game of all time. It's not. It's not even the most engaging game of all time. It doesn't have the best story of all time. But
because you don't know what's going on.
I will say, you don't know what's going on until the end, where you have some idea, but you don't have all your questions answered.
There's some deeper aspects of it too. A lot of theory. It's one of those games where people come up with theories to what it actually means and what it's a big metaphor for. It's got that super ambiguous story, kind of like Braid did.
Yeah.
Probably.
I was about to say, not another fucking Braid.
It's in that realm. I got to the end and I'm like, what did I just witness? And I had to look up reviews, and I looked what people thought about it, and I watched there's another ending. I watched that, and wow.
So it's definitely not the best game of all time. It's not a $60 game. I wouldn't pay more than $15 for this. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But I will say that it is by far the most complete game I have played in years. This doesn't feel like something that, you know, they carved out stuff that they took, you know, they shortened their development cycle, they ran out of time. It doesn't feel like that at all. It feels like this is a game that's 100% done in the way that Playdead wanted to release it. It's complete.
So
and
we have
a really good feeling. And it's odd to say that, but it's a really unique feeling to have a game that's done. It's a package. Yeah. That's what you get.
So we didn't really describe that much about the type of game it is, though. We can compare it to Limbo, but if you haven't played Limbo, it's a puzzle platformer. Light puzzle elements. They're not tricky puzzles. I think these puzzles are even easier than Limbo was for me.
Yes, they are.
But it's very much just sit down and experience it, explore as you go, take in the visuals and try to figure out what's going on.
Yeah, I listened to a lot of Giant Bomb, and I heard this, that the puzzler aspect of it is just mediocre at best, and it's just a device to get you through the game.
Yeah, the gameplay basically is driven by your desire to know more what's happening and to see the rest of the world.
Yeah, it's definitely a game you play for the environments, for, you know, to try to figure out what's going on. The only reason, you know, I played it, not because the gameplay was anything spectacular, but because I wanted to know what WTF, what the hell? I mean, seriously.
Super dark, super beautiful
things, and then this guy, and what the fuck? Now, you just shot a kid in the face.
Didn't it win an award at the Game Awards?
It won best art.
Was it for the art direction?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought it was
For the I can't remember the dude, but the one that live streamed on Twitch. Yeah, that was like the best art direction or something like that. It was between that, The Witness, and something else.
Mm-hmm. I could definitely see that.
I might check it out at some point, but I'll be honest, it looks beautiful. It just doesn't really tickle my fancy necessarily.
I can understand that.
I heard some spoilers on it.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, the Giant Bomb Game of the Year shit at the end, I listened to that and I heard some spoilers on it. So where it sounds interesting, sounds good, just not sure it's something I would play.
Yeah. At least look up some screenshots of the beautiful art.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, we can take our background. That's of course desaturated and in the background of our video podcast. That's straight from inside. So if you look up some screenshots, if you're gonna play it, try not to try to spoil anything for yourself by looking stuff up. But
just play it.
Definitely check it out.
Yeah. So that's about all I've played. If you don't have anything else to add to Inside, Tom.
No, that's about all I had to say. It's
Eric, what have you played this week? I want to know what you played.
So I had a little bit of the normal. Had some Rocket League, of course. Did a little bit of VR. A buddy of mine was giving me all sorts of shit for not using Google Earth VR yet.
Oh, yeah.
So I booted it up. And I don't know if I'm just a jaded son of a bitch, but this thing has gotten these monstrous glowing reviews of, oh my God, it's the best VR experience out there. You got to try it.
Yeah.
And I was underwhelmed, to be honest.
Really?
The big cities are nice in 3D. Yeah, they put some touch on the big cities. I was able to go in front of my house. It wasn't quite street level, but it was okay. Yeah. I went back home where I grew up. It's still just 2D flat textures.
I guess that sucks.
They didn't want to put the processing power into the corn and bean fields out there. And
that makes
the one story houses.
Can you really blame them?
Go ahead.
Well, I was gonna say, so in general, it's cool. It is free. By all means, you should check it out. Like, if you want to go through Tokyo or Beijing or something like that, it's kind of cool because the cities are bigger. But all in all, I don't see this as this big time sink kind of interactive thing that some people are saying it is.
It's not. It's absolutely not. But it gave me a very unique VR experience because where, you know, some things like there's, you know, games on your list like Rec Room or Space Pirate Trainer or, you know, any number of VR games out for the Vive right now, they're all fun. They're all lighthearted. They're all action movie hero type games. Google Earth let me do something in completely different. You know, I got to sit in a tiny, tiny ass fishing village, you know, on the other side of the world and watch the sunset. It was just it, while, you know, some soothing music is playing in the background, it was chill as fuck. It was a, you know, Google Earth VR is not a place where I went to win anything or be anyone. I just got to chill the fuck out. It's a place I wanted to be. And that's, I think, one of the most promising aspects of VR that's been criminally underdeveloped so far.
I can see that.
I mean, if I want something that's chill, I'm going to boot up Tilt Brush and I'm going to kind of be Bob Rossing it up in 3D space. But I mean, that is just, it's, I don't know. It's not, it doesn't grab me. I'm sorry. That's just how I am. It's okay. The other ones fair. I played though, Space Pirate Trainer or Simulator. Ooh, it was the first time I booted it up in a while.
Yeah. I had so much fun with
that. They updated it a lot.
Oh, did they?
So they added some new guns. There's like this grenade launcher that you squeeze twice. First squeeze shoots, second squeeze detonates.
Ooh.
So you just start launching these things and just bam, bam. It's awesome because concussion pushes them aside. So they'll actually start running into each other and stuff. There is a tractor beam sword that you can switch your shield out for.
My favorite. So
you can, like, pull these, you can pull these things in and slam them on the ground. Or pull them in with the one hand and tee off with them home run style with the other. So they have so some really
that,
cool.
I watched Tom do that for like 30 minutes at his house.
So you grab, you know, dual tractor beam swords and you go full like God of War Blades of Chaos on these robots, swinging them around, smashing them into each other, just going nuts. Yeah.
And real quick, for those who don't know, Space Pirate Trainer is a VR stand in place. Well, kind of, it's room scale, but you stay in one area and mm-hmm. these drones come up in waves. And you're defending yourself with a shield and dodging while shooting them. So it's both hands switching between guns and shield, duck, dodging, and shooting. And when the lasers that they shoot gets close to you, it goes matrix mode. So you can actually dodge them or use the new sword to deflect it like you're a fucking Jedi. It's really fun. It's developed into a very nice game. It sucks because this genre of game in VR is fucking everywhere, but yeah. It's very fun. And then I got back into Rec Room. The first time I played Rec Room in a while, paintballing, that is still one of the best shooting experiences ever.
Which one is Rec Room?
So Rec Room is, think of this, like you're in a high school and you're all mm-hmm. just hanging out in the common area. And there's like basketballs you can shoot and you just talk and hang out with people. And then there's all these mini games that you can all collectively go into in your own lobbies. Now, this is weird because right now it's probably because of the price point of the Vive and Oculus. But the community is so fucking good.
Yeah.
Everyone in this game is friendly, talkative, just there to have a good time. I think the price points help.
Of Dota.
Well, exact yeah. opposite of almost any online game. Like Call of Duty, Halo, all that shit. You got a lot of trolls. This is people purely wanting to have a good time. Like you'll walk in and people instantly start high-fiving you and fist bumping you and like, hey, let's go play paintball or let's go play frisbee golf. And it's just really, it's a good feel. Yeah, or there's a shield soccer game that Tom really liked that I was fucking dreadful at. But all in all, it's a really good social, fun VR game. It's free. It's just really fun. Nice. And then I played one more game, and I played a lot of that, actually. And I've had it for a while. Mm-hmm. Pokemon Sun. I've eclipsed the 90-hour mark. I am two Pokemon away from having every Pokemon in the game, and I probably get those later tonight because they're in Moon, and she's getting those for me.
Of course.
So I have put a fuck ton of time in that.
Yeah, no kidding. That's incredible.
I enjoy it. I enjoy it. It's a good, solid game. And later this month, they're opening up the Pokemon database to where you can start bringing in classics art that are not part of the native game. So you get your Charizards and your Blastoise and stuff and your Cyndaquils and all those.
That's awesome. That's perfect.
So it's really good for everyone who's been worried that there is no gyms. I know I've hit on it once before, but I'll drive it home. They more than make up for it with the trial system. The one thing I will say now that I'm 90 hours in, the end game is very light. I'm coming from playing Omega Ruby where the end game's almost as long as the fucking game. End game is very, very light.
Hmm.
So other than that, it's gorgeous, great game. The storyline sucks, but it's Pokemon, so who really cares?
Yeah.
But it's fun.
Too busy catching them all to care about your problem.
Yeah, literally here, I was just running around evolving and shit to the point where at the very end of Elite Four, I was evolving everything so much I didn't have a good fighting party. It made the Elite Four really fucking hard.
You did this to yourself, Eric.
Yes, I did. I learned from my mistakes. But that's all I've been playing, really.
Nice.
So, Tom, heard you bought a new toy.
I did. But first, I'm going to show you my plastic bits. I've got plastic bits here. And you're not going to know what these are for a little bit, but they do snap together like so, if I could do it. It's hard to snap them together. It's hard to get them unsnapped, but that's a good thing. It creates like this cool little shape, and I realize this is probably terrible radio, but we will be posting just this segment of the hardware review on our YouTube channel in addition to the podcast. So if you want just to watch me check out this little hardware device I've got now, you can go to youtube.com/72pinconnector to grab the video after the fact. All right, so a hardware review just for you. I bought this, the NES 30 Pro. It is a... Man, I messed up my camera, and I've got to get all this thing situated again. All right. It is a wireless controller, Bluetooth. It's got a micro USB port for charging. It has literally every button that you would see on a standard, PS3, PS4, or 360 X-Bone controller. It's got two shoulder buttons, but they are not analog. They're just regular buttons. It's got two USB sticks, complete with the click-down buttons. It's got the four buttons off the right, and what I really needed for all of my retro gaming is a really nice D-pad. Now, this guy is great, and I've got Mario and Luigi here to help me do some unboxing. So one thing I was really impressed with is the packaging itself. This thing is like 40-ish bucks on Amazon right now. You might be able to find it cheaper somewhere else, but we'll go ahead and remove the sleeve. It comes with, and I don't know why it does this, because I don't like keychains. It comes with a like G3 keychain. Okay, whatever. We'll toss that. Here's the controller itself. It's actually way, way lighter than I expected. I thought this thing was going to have, at least some metal trimming on it, but it's all plastic. It's all very light, even with the battery. Which doesn't appear to be removable, but that's okay because it's, internally charged. And the battery life, I haven't gotten it to die yet, and I've been using it for the past 2 days. But the D-pad, buttons, everything feels very good. If you've used other, knockoff non-Nintendo controllers before, they do feel kind of, the buttons are mushy and stuff. These feel very responsive, very clean. The only thing I don't like is... Analog sticks are really tiny. I mean, look at those. And they're pretty sensitive. I mean, you go to push down, to get that nice click, and they'll shift. So if you're trying to click precisely without moving your camera or whatever, that's not going to work most of the time. And then you've got two buttons on the bottom for powering it up and controlling it. Now, on the sides here, you've got this nice ring of beautiful LED lighting that's got full color LEDs that all mean something. So blue, this nice breathing blue that it's doing now means it's currently connected, which I'll show you here in a bit. But also in the box, we've got this cool pull-out tab. Instruction booklet, which isn't all in Chinese, so I'm very happy with that. Everything old is new again. I mean, look at this. This is like Apple levels of packaging in here. And again, I don't know why. I don't get it, but, you know, that's fine. Another stupid keychain. Okay, I guess that's fine. Yeah, I'm not going to complain. It's free, right? I bought the controller, but all this stuff came with it. One thing I am very happy about is a micro USB cable, and it's not some crappy cable. This is one of the thin ones. Comes with it, comes coiled up nicely, and works perfectly. So you don't have to go and scrounge around, although you've probably got, you know, 100 of these laying around. Controller compatibility. This guy works with PC, you know, Linux, Mac, Windows, all of it. I've used it on everything. It works on everything. It's plug and play. It's Bluetooth, so you have to have Bluetooth. Sort of. You can actually get away with not having Bluetooth. You can power it on and then use your micro USB cable to plug it in, and it just becomes a USB joystick. So you don't even have to have a wireless dongle to use this, which is a
Actually going to ask you that, because Bluetooth alone for desktops sucks. Laptops, you can get away with it. Phones, you get away with it. But a desktop.
When I'm sitting here at my desk, I just plug it in. And of course, you know, it charges the battery when it's plugged in too. And it just works. There's nothing to configure. You just plug it in and go. I use this with Steam Big Picture Mode. You have to configure the controller for that, because it gets a little weird because the defaults aren't quite set up properly. But for something like RetroArch, which is what I play all my retro games on, it works perfectly out of the box. But that's it for the package.
So my question is this beneficial to have over a 360 controller? Because, I mean, the 360 controller gives you essentially the same button layout.
It depends on your use case. Yes, that's why. So, of course, my 360 controllers are behind me. But the 360 controller, the D-pad is dog shit. It is by far one of the worst D-pads I've used, especially for fighting games. And I used to play all my retro games with this. This guy? That's a legit D-pad. That's a Nintendo-style D-pad. It is wonderful in every way. It doesn't feel quite as crisp as a classic NES controller, but it's the closest thing I've come to. I even like it more than the DualShocks. If you don't care about wireless at all, and you don't care about D-pad functionality at all, a wired off-brand 360 controller will get you through just fine. There's no reason to switch from that. But if you want something portable, if you want something that'll work with your phone, get this. One note, this won't work with iPhone unless the iPhone is jailbroken. Because the way Apple, it's really killer for people with iPhones, because with the way Apple implemented the controller spec, they didn't want to pay the Apple tax to get this, you know, certified by Apple to use on iOS. So it doesn't work with Android. I just connected the Bluetooth device and it worked. So speaking of, this was on the previous stream. I've got to take this apart. Okay. I bought plastic pieces that came in this box, which is way less impressive. But my plastic pieces here, they snap together like this. And they're hard to get together.
It takes an engineer to figure out how to snap these two plastic pieces together.
All right. So this thing is weird, but I got it for one purpose. These two divots line up with these buttons on the bottom. So what we can do, take this guy. I'm going to move the camera because this will be way easier. All right. We're going to take this guy.
That's a fucking nice. Yes, it is. Goes.
Look at this. So now, you still got access to the buttons. It's held in here. But how are you going to play all your retro games on the go with a big bulky laptop? Answer, you're just fucking not. So, get one of these guys. We're going to load a recent game here. We're going to take this, and as you can see, the back is actually really nice. All spring-loaded inside. It's got these nice rubber stoppers on the top and bottom. Put this in here. And by the way, for size reference, this is a Nexus 6P in a case. It's a big-ass phone, and I've still got, you know, half an inch, third of an inch to spare. So this will fit literally every phone. Maybe not, you know, giant tablets, but look at that. It's perfect. It's just perfect. So you can now play these games anywhere on the go all the time. If you're looking for a really nice emulator for Android, RetroArch is free in the Google Play Store. Of course, provide your own ROMs that you have legally acquired from your legal backup system of choice. And that's about it. Yeah, hold the button on the bottom to turn it off. So far, I love it. I was playing Rocket League with it. It works pretty well. You gotta get used to the tiny analog sticks. That's my only complaint. Other than that, it's great. It works everywhere. And I've gotten around the weird controller layout by remapping buttons in certain places. Weird meaning it's not a standard 360 controller. But other than that, I absolutely love it. The connector thing for the phone is like $10. The controller itself was like $40. And you can also get it, instead of if you didn't want to do the NES style, you can get it in a Famicom style, so it's got the red and gold look to it. So if you're in the need for a wireless controller, go for it.
Yeah, I was thinking about getting some Bluetooth for the big picture, because I was using a wired version of the 360 controller. Ended up using a PS4 controller that worked pretty well, but still wasn't exactly what I was hoping for.
I totally forgot to say something in regards to the controller. So NES 30 Pro, 8-Bit Do is the company behind it. We will provide an Amazon link to both products in the show notes and in the description and wherever the text is on this video. But they are releasing firmware updates. So if you have a bug or something, you can report it to them. They'll release some more firmware. But they do have this cool thing called the advanced firmware, and they've got the extended modes manual, which will make this work with a bunch of other stuff, which is fucking crazy. Okay, so Retron 5, the actual console you plug other people's cartridges into, it'll work with that. If you wanted to use this with a PS3 as a PS3 controller, they have a firmware that will emulate a DualShock.
Oh, nice.
And let you use this as a PS3 controller. If you wanted to hook this to a Wiimote wirelessly to use this as a pro controller for a Wii or Wii U, you can also do that with specified firmware.
Very cool.
Will literally do everything you want it to. I am very, very impressed. It's got a bunch of different modes. So in case your program doesn't have joystick capabilities, but it does have keys, you can set that to emulate a Bluetooth keyboard. So when you hit a button, it's like pressing a key on a keyboard, and it works with everything anyway. On Android, if you have a rooted phone, you can have it press certain areas of a touchscreen. Really, it's nuts. I mean, this thing is great. Some of the best software I've used in a very long time. So, pick one up. I highly recommend it. And no, I'm not getting paid. I'm just very happy.
Good. That's nice.
And that was an official 72-pin connector hardware review. To find more hardware reviews, check us out at twitch.tv/72pinconnector, on YouTube, at 72 pin connector, or go to 72 pin connector.com.
Yeah. We'll get that at the end.
Okay. Yeah, we don't need to do that. Okay. So we do have a little bit of news. We'll start with a really, really weird one that sounded like a practical joke. Adam, please tell us about this Resident Evil 7 candle.
Candle, you heard it. Resident Evil 7 is going to be VR supported. And what more to immerse your experience in the world of Resident Evil 7 than Smell-O-Vision? It's finally here, boys. We have a Resident Evil candle.
You see, I always thought it was going to be the Futurama, the smelloscope, where like they just have some nozzles that go into your nose.
Right. Yeah. So it's called the Blood, Sweat, and Fears candle, and it's supposed to smell like musty old timber and blood. So light that bad boy up, stick on that VR headset, and become immersed.
I would say that, yeah, this is very fucking weird for Capcom to release something like this, but it's not out of character at all for the Resident Evil team. Did you guys ever buy the Chainsaw GameCube controller?
No.
It was a GameCube controller shaped like a chainsaw released for Resident Evil 4. It had like blood splatter paint on it. It was amazing. So while this is fucking weird, it doesn't surprise me in the least.
And I think it's like I think it's $16.
Much for a candle.
Yeah.
How long?
It's got like 15, 16 hours of life in it. So it should get you through the game.
So I'm calling it now. There will be a fire in someone's house because they lit this candle, started playing VR, and had no fucking clue where they were in the room.
Yep.
And all
or they
sudden,
can put it in a safe place, like a responsible adult outside of the playing area. You can smell the candle throughout the whole living area if you put it in the corner safely somewhere.
Man, I'm telling you this right now. When I get into VR, playing areas go out the fucking window. I punched the wall the other day. I was playing frisbee golf, man, and I had to throw that thing fucking far and over this goddamn hill. And next thing I know, I'm throwing right into a wall.
Okay, because this is 72 pin connector, I'm going to tangent the fuck out of this. Okay, Rec Room, disc golf, are you any good at that at all? Because I suck. I am terrible.
I was averaging about bogey until the last hole when I lost my frisbee.
So much better than me. I like had like a million by the end of the game. It was so bad. Anyway.
So yeah, pick up a Resident Evil candle if you want. I guess
compatible with all game systems.
Compatible with everything.
It's wireless.
No, in
and it's heat activated.
Yeah, there's no microtransactions. Well, you have to buy a lighter.
Oh shit! That's how
is that the equivalent of an in? Is that an in-game purchase?
No.
They actually have a credit card swipe on the bottom of the candle, where you swipe it and it unlocks a lighter for you.
Or it drops one match, but if you break that match, you have to swipe it again. It's a 10-cent microtransaction each time.
They could add a button on the main menu to order candles and lighters to go with it.
Great.
Oh, God. Okay, so there was...
A day one candle patch?
I just got a lovely text message everyone will enjoy. Reading from my lovely girlfriend, you punched the wall. So, yes, in fact, I ratted myself out on that. Fantastic.
Hey, anyway, some things, what happens in VR stays in VR.
Unless you put a hole in a fucking wall.
Well, did you put a hole in the wall, though?
There are marks on the side.
It's probably fine.
Okay, so.
I'm sure we have something more interesting than a candle.
That doesn't look fine over there. Yes. That's not good.
We had some interesting news come out of CES, just a little bit so far. It goes until Sunday, so hopefully Microsoft takes the stage. They actually take HoloLens somewhere. But for now, we're dealing with two things. One awesome, one stupid as hell. On the stupid side, Razer has put out a gaming laptop. Now you think that sounds cool. It runs a NVIDIA 1080. You think that's really fucking strong. Awesome. And then you find out it's a tri-panel. It has three fucking screens.
The fuck?
It looked like it was going to take off and fly away.
Like, I thought I was confused by the ending of Limbo, but this takes it to a whole nother level.
I'm just imagining somebody sitting on a park bench, and he opens the laptop, and then he spreads the two screens out to the side, and the wind catches it just right, and it goes flying off into the distance, never to be seen again.
Yeah, it's,
it looks ridiculous.
It's fucking absurd.
So a 1080 in a laptop, so not only are you getting 3 seconds of battery life, but now you have a fully functioning portable fireplace. So if you're lost in the woods and you need to start a fire, just boot that up and load up GTA 5. Crank that thing to ultra and you've got a fireplace instantly.
I'm just trying to think of the practical uses of that. I mean, I guess... Well, if for somebody that doesn't own a desktop PC, maybe they could use that at home like that and then fold it down to one screen when they're out and about.
I barely had an excuse. I was in college. I was a PC gamer and I bought an Asus Republic of Gamers gaming laptop for my schoolwork.
Schoolwork.
That is hardly an excuse. I should have bought like a Chromebook or something crappy. And built a desktop and saved myself, you know, $1,000. But
so
it's gaming laptops are never a good idea.
Yeah.
In the Twitch stream or chat, just imagine this: you're sitting on an already crowded plane, flying across the fucking country, knowing you're in there for 4 hours. You have guy on the left sleeping on your fucking shoulder, and guy on your right opens up his laptop, and his fucking monitors go across your goddamn lap. Or worse yet, that's the guy in the middle. His monitors spread on both people's laps in front of them. I mean, just
except,
so absurd.
Get some picture.
Playing
picture.
Dota.
Yeah.
The Dota running at the same time, and he's screaming Russian insults into his microphone.
Wow.
Because that's the kind of person who has that laptop.
Okay, so CES shows a lot of tech, a lot of crazy ass tech that no one needs nor wants. But Intel has finally shown, yes, tweet from the blends, but Intel has finally showed their hand in VR. They have already announced in the past their Project Alloy. Well, they had a demo, and this shit looks cool as hell. So it is a VR setup that does not take any lighthouses like Vive or the room scale equivalent of Oculus. This thing will scan your room and identify the objects in your room. And granted, this is only for this one game they were using. It put those objects in the game. So if you have a couch, it would be a structure that you're hiding behind to be able to shoot. They put real life structures into the game.
That's kind of cool. I like that idea.
We did watch a demo video on this, and it looks really, really freaking cool.
So the VR headset itself is the engine. It's not like the Vive where you have to have this powerful ass computer behind it. This thing is loaded with an 6th-gen i7 processor. I think it was i7. I might be wrong on that, but it's a current-gen, top-of-the-line processor. So it has its own computational power. This fucking thing would just scan the room. These two guys are looking around the room. It scans it, puts it into the game, and then they have this wave-based shooter going on where they're hiding behind stuff, being able to see each other the whole time, tracking them perfectly. It looked amazing.
The only issue I can see with this is, you know, you duck behind cover behind, like, you know, this metal wall, and it's like your fuzzy couch, and you're like, what the, this isn't quite right. I can see that taking you out of the experience pretty quickly.
Well,
I don't know, man. To me, I play with my shirt on, so I'm not going to be able to feel this fuzzy couch. I'm just going to feel that I'm up against some object.
You don't VR naked?
Come on, okay, you're talking a different VR experience than I have. I will never buy those attachments, sir. Never.
Bye.
Oh, I'm just imagining the thing overheating and melting somebody's face off.
Yeah.
Like, don't let Samsung get a hold of the thing.
Oh, God. The Galaxy Note VR explosion. Feel the boom. Oh, God, that would be terrible.
It looks cool, though.
I'm excited. It's just, it's not something that'll play well with Oculus and Vive. Those two will play in the same ecosystem. This will not. Well, this would be hard because you can't write games for those two and work with the Intel version.
Yeah.
That's my big concern with everything that's not, you know, either jumping onto the, you know, OpenVR Vive bandwagon slash everything else or Oculus bandwagon is that the tech looks really cool. It does some really interesting stuff, but you have to build for that one platform. And are people, you know, it's a chicken or egg problem, right? People aren't going to buy it if there's no software there, but developers aren't going to write software for it if no one buys the hardware. So how do you do that, right? At least with the Vive, it's coming from Valve, or if they say, hey, we put on a toaster, it doesn't really do anything else. It's got the number 3 written on the side of it, and it just makes toast. And we're selling it for $700. I would buy one, right? Everyone else would buy one too. They're great, and it's made by Valve.
But there's,
you know, Oculus had viral marketing out the ass, and everyone jumped onto that. So I don't know.
There's one thing that could go for it. This could be the first one where they could actually sell this as a console. All the other VRs are tag-alongs. This may be powered to the point. Do you have a PC? You can run this. And if it gets sold at that, it would be able to undercut the other ones in price and still be able to keep the performance.
Yeah.
And if they can manage that, this actually could help.
It'd reach a wider market than PSVR, probably.
Yeah, because the PSVR is a $400 PlayStation and then about a $400 headset.
Right.
So, I mean, it's still the Oculus price, only you don't need the PC. So, I mean, if this comes out at a $400 to $500 price point and it's as vibrant as a Vive, I mean, they're going to undercut the fuck out of Vive and Oculus with that.
Yeah.
But anyway.
But we'll see.
That is
definitely looking to see some more for that.
Yeah, that is all we have from CES so far. I'm sure if there's anything really cool, you hear us rant about it next week. But as of right now, this is all that's really came out to really show the gaming world some cool stuff.
Gamifying Wi-Fi blenders.
Hey, LG's already showing off their smart fridges.
I know.
Yeah. Jesus.
There's one practical purpose Flappy is fridge. The inside camera is kind of cool to be able to see what's in your fridge if you're out grocery shopping.
Like
I can see that.
I feel like an old man yelling at kids on their Game Boys now. Like, open the fucking fridge. Jesus Christ.
Back when I was a kid, we made a grocery list and we stuck to it.
You know what I've got on my fridge? You know what I've got? I've got, you know, a magnetic notepad and a pen on a string. And you know what happens when we need food? We write it down.
You know what Not happens whenever Tom goes to the grocery store? He forgets it.
Yeah, he leaves the paper on the fridge.
Yeah, so I do have, you know, Google Keep, and I put stuff in Google Keep, and it just stays there. It's notes. Write yourself an email. I mean, do fucking anything. You don't have to have cameras in the goddamn fridge.
So
unless I stop
it. But if you had enough,
let me paraphrase this real quick. You just said the fridge is too high tech. Write yourself an email instead. You just said that.
I did.
You just said that.
Wi-Fi refrigerators are solutions looking for problems. Same thing with all of the Internet of Things, right? They don't actually make our lives easier. They don't solve any problems. If anything, they make things more complicated, bug and error prone. And not to mention the security nightmare around all this shit when, you know, your refrigerator doesn't get patched. So now it's got Pornhub playing on it because some old hacker thought it would be hilarious to ship APKs out to Samsung's shitty bug-laden developer portal, and now every fridge has got Pornhub on it. Hilarious.
As yes, it should be.
I don't want to own one, right?
Yeah.
The
you
Internet
don't want
of
porn
things
with your fridge?
Unless I specifically choose the porn, right? I've got standards. I don't want just like randomized red tube videos coming down the pipeline. I mean, come on, I'm not a savage. But yeah, the Internet of Things don't actually solve problems for anyone. They claim all these solutions, but they're all looking for problems to solve. Like, have you ever like needed to figure out how many eggs you have by like this thing? It's a Wi-Fi egg holder for your fridge. And by the way, if you think I'm joking, that's a legit fucking product that you can buy. There's an app you can install on your phone and it's got like eggs and you can count how many eggs there are in this little stupid Wi-Fi egg tray. You have to stop me now. Tom, I will go all night.
Tom, I'm going to stop you because you are turning into the old man and aging by the statement. You are growing older every sentence you spew.
It's so bad. And I'm a security guy.
Yeah.
That's my other podcast. Go there. If
you're the tech guy. You're the one that's supposed to be installing Linux on the fridges. And
oh, I do. But my Linux fridge gets kernel updates on a regular basis, right? Every month I reboot.
And it crashes when you open the door.
That's fine.
To open the door, he has to run Wine.
Yes. The door software is not compatible with Linux. It has one version that worked on Windows XP.
Okay. So enough of CES, enough of Tom being a grandpa,
and
enough of porn fridges. So there was a little bit more news. I think Tom would like to talk about some speed running going on this weekend.
Yes, this weekend, starting Sunday, Awesome Games Done Quick, which is a fantastic 24 hours, 24, not seven. I think they go for like 3 days. But anyway, like 72 hours straight. They might take an hour break in between a couple of those. But Awesome Games Done Quick. They are a fantastic charity speedrunning event that happens twice a year. Awesome Games Done Quick in the winter, starting Sunday. And then Summer Games Done Quick, done in the spring, amazingly enough, which is a lie. It's done in the summer. So January 8th starts at 11:30 a.m. Yes, that's Eastern time. So 11:30 a.m. Eastern time. Check it out. They'll be on Twitch. They always post their VODs to YouTube. They are fantastic. They help all kinds of charities, most notably, Doctors Without Borders and the Prevent Cancer Foundation. They have raised a collective $8 million for charity. So they'll be soliciting donations and showing us the best glitches, exploits, tricks, and speedruns of the year. So check that out. Even if you don't know if speedruns are your thing, there's always something fucking nuts going on at AGDQ. So check it out.
Those are always interesting.
And it's a charity thing going on. So
yeah, I saw somebody speedrun The Witness of all things. And he got through the main game in like 30 minutes.
Ridiculous.
Memorized the puzzles. That's absurd. He memorized the puzzles.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's the level of dedication to a game I'm not willing to do.
And the whole time he's sitting there interacting with Twitch chat, answering questions and stuff. I'm like, oh my god, a little monster.
The last day of it. is amazing. One of my favorites. People don't really consider it pure speedrunning because it's not really done by humans, but they program bots and scripts to run games for them. Not like AI stuff, but they use tools to assist them beating the game as fast as a computer would be able to beat it, using all kinds of like frame-specific exploits and bugs and stuff like that. It's always a good time. Do you guys ever play the brain training games on the DS? Yes. Math problems and simple puzzles. Okay, they've got TaskBot, tool assisted speedrun bot, which is like a mangled Rob the robot holding a controller plugged into a various machines. TaskBot will draw pictures where they're supposed to like be writing down numbers and stuff and solving math problems. They will draw pictures, but it will freak out the number recognition system enough that it'll actually come up with the right answer each time. It's fantastic, so check it out.
Rob the robot. A lot of places are using him. The worst peripheral Nintendo ever made, still getting a lot of use today.
I don't know. I mean, I've got an e-reader. That's up there.
Okay, the only thing I put above is the fucking power glove.
Hey, don't you blaspheme. This is still 72-pin connector. God damn
that
it.
Power glove is garbage.
I will not have my power glove blasphemed on my own podcast.
Okay, so there's one more little tidbit of news for all you Mass Effect 2 Mass Effect fans. Mass Effect 2 is currently free on Origin. If you're listening to this on a podcast, you better hurry. I'm not sure how long it's going to last. But as of Friday, January 6th, it is free. Have you guys ever played Mass Effect 2?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
I have it, but I never did actually play it. I played a demo, I think, at one point. So I played a little bit of the gameplay, but I did not actually play the game.
Mass Effect is one of my favorite RPGs of all time. It was 120 hours. It made me scream, cry, throw things, angry shitpost on Twitter. I mean, all of the good emotions that go through you as a gamer. And Mass Effect 2 is by far the best one in the series. It's if you haven't played a Mass Effect game, 2 is definitely the one to try out first.
Yeah, I've heard that's the better of the three.
Yeah,
I've heard it's the best, but do you really want to play 2 before 1? Because doesn't your 1 save go into 2?
It does. So what's cool about Mass Effect, in case you didn't know, is when you play the first Mass Effect, you know, you get done with this big character arc and you've made choices that are impactful to the world. Mm-hmm. How are you going to balance that with a sequel? And most games just say, your choices don't really matter in the end, and here's the sequel. Mass Effect did something different where they said, hey, we're going to take your first save game and we're going to import that into 2. So the Commander Shepard you were in Mass Effect 1 is the Commander Shepard you are in 2. And the same with 2 to 3. So you're really not playing three different games. You're playing one 120-hour epic where you are the same character and your choices matter in this game.
To a degree.
But to a degree. To as much as they can. Yeah. But with if you start on Mass Effect 2 or 3, what happens is the game will say, hey, here's the big choices. Here's a synopsis of the story. It's not the same as going through and making the hard choices yourself, but they do sort of emulate and bring you up to speed in a decent way. It's not like The Witcher where they throw you in and say, have fun, kid.
Okay. I think that's all we have for this week, but Adam...
But it's not.
Has us a... What? Oh.
I was going to say, there's Adam a gaming fact.
Yeah,
we always have a gaming fact. Us a little bit of fact.
I do have a gaming fact.
So what
fact.
Do you have for us this week, Adam?
Well, as usual, this comes from Did You Know Gaming, which I would definitely check out their site, didyouknowgaming.com. They have a lot of interesting stuff. This one has to do with Super Meat Boy. We both like Super Meat Boy.
Yay!
All three of us. In Super Meat Boy for the PC, if you type PETA file on the character select screen, you'll be able to play as Tofu Boy. Tofu Boy can't run and can barely jump, making him the game's worst character of all time.
Oh my
Tofu
god.
Tofu Boy is a joke mocking a Flash game parody of Super Meat Boy that was made by PETA.
Wow.
Oh my god, that's amazing.
PETA took stab at Super Meat Boy and they stabbed right back with the worst character ever designed.
I thought we like showered these guys with love last podcast. I didn't think I could love them anymore.
Honest question. There does you anyone go. Know, can the game be beat as Tofu Boy? Or is it you suck so bad you have to die?
No, you wouldn't be able to do anything in the game if you can't run.
Ah, true. You need to get the speed.
Yeah, running would get you to like the sixth level of the first world or something like that.
I'm going to have to start that game up again just to do that and check it out.
Amazing.
Well, I think that's all we got for you guys this week, though.
PETA made Tofu Boy.
That let that register a little bit. But you guys can always get at us through the week. You can tweet at us at 72PCPodcast. You can check out our old videos, hardware reviews, game reviews, all that fun stuff at 72-Pin Connector on YouTube. You could email us if you don't like Twitter at fanmail@72pinconnector.com. And on our website, 72pinconnector.com, we will have links to all of our materials that we have been posting for you guys. So, until next week, game on.
Game on.
Bye.